today, we will hear from Adam Greaves, who comes from Colville in England. Adam graduated from Cardiff University with a Bachelor of Arts, majoring in English and Music. He toured Europe with various orchestras and wind bands. The tours included the Edinburgh Festival of Arts, plus arts festivals in France and Italy. He was also a member of the Cardiff University Orchestra and was invited on a special occasion to play second horn in the Welsh National Opera Orchestra. Adam is at present studying for a Master of Music Performance at the Elder Conservatorium of the University of Adelaide. He is supported by a postgraduate scholarship from the University of Adelaide, and he will talk with David Boyd this afternoon.
Welcome to International Links, Adam.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
We haven't had the chance of talking to many musicians on this programme, so we're very pleased to have you here. Perhaps a little information about what's involved in horn playing. But we'd like, first of all, to hear a little bit about where you come from, because we don't speak to many English folk either. What part of England is Colville in?
I was actually born in London, hence the accent. I put lots of R's in words like bath and glass like that, so rather than glass and bath, which is what they say in Leicestershire. At Colville, I moved there when I was 7 years old. I moved up there because of my dad's job. Moved up there. It was a mining town, as the name suggests, and I went to school right opposite where the big lifts came out of the ground to take all the miners down. So there was lots of mining folk, and when I worked in a pub there, I often had long conversations about what it was like down in the mine with all the miners, and stories about how canaries passing out because of the gas and all of those sorts of things and the cramp conditions down there.
Yeah, I also come from a mining village, and one thing is that in the cold weather, it's much more comfortable underground.
Oh, I'm sure it is, yeah.
How big is the town? How about you, Colville?
It's probably about 35,000 people, I would imagine.
Oh, it's a good size, Dave.
It's a fair size. I mean, there's two or three high schools in it as well. So there's, and it's always expanding as well. I live in one of the newer areas on the outside of Colville. It's about 14 miles from the main city of Leicester. Mm. And we've got Ashby de la Zouche just down the road as well, about another 4 miles, which I think that's about 6 kilometres in new money. I'm not used to working in kilometres since I've been out here.
And is it still a mining coal?
No, the coal mines are all shut now. The mine that I said was opposite my primary school when I grew up has now been filled in, and it's now a science museum as well. So it's always good fun to take people there, and we have tours around the mine as well. Not that we can go down, but we can at least get inside the lifts, even if they don't go anywhere.
And what's the town like? Would you recognise a mining village, or is it better architecture?
Oh, yeah, it's lots of terraced houses. It sprung up in a hurry when they discovered coal there. And they put lots of houses into as small a space as they possibly could. So hence, huge, great, big, long houses in lots of rows.
And what's the region roundabout like? Any historical buildings?
Oh, we've got a few historical buildings. We've got in Bradgate Park, which is one of the national parks that we often walk the dogs in. There's the house of Lady Jane Grey, who was the first Queen of England. She ruled for the grand total of 9 days and never left the Tower of London in the whole course of her reign.
And she came to a rather sticky end.
To a sticky end, actually. She got her head lopped off after her dad was involved in a plot of some description. And we got Bosworth Battlefield down the road as well, which is where Henry Tudor defeated Richard III to start off the Tudor dynasty of kings and queens.
Oh, that's a most important place.
No, it is. Well, when I was growing up, I've been around there many times. There's a visitor centre there as well. And since I've been out here, so it must have been about April time, they actually discovered that the site of the battle was about 3 kilometres away from where they originally thought it was. They've built this lovely visitor centre, done it out really nice. They've been refurbishing it over the last few years, and it's now in the...
I gather, by the way, that the Ashby de la Zouche comes into Ivanhoe.
It does, yes. We've got that, and we've got Ashby Castle as well. Forgot about that one. And so it's all in ruins now.
So there's plenty of interest around the area.
Oh, yeah, there's lots around. We've got the Charnwood Forest as well, which is coming up, up and about.
I know that part of England is rich farming country. So that suggests that you've got probably some good foods around there.
We have. I mean, we're most famous probably for pork pies. But until about October last year, I was actually vegetarian, so I've never had one. I'm not vegetarian anymore, although I've been out here since March. And I never had a pork pie before I left. But there's, of course, Stilton cheese, which is one of our favourites.
Oh, absolute luxury. It's beautiful stuff.
Oh, yes, yeah, very nice.
Yeah, I've never been able to get as good cheese as I had when actually in Rutland over the border. Mm. Guan from Colville, you were a student at Cardiff University.
That's right.
Did you find South Wales very different from Leicestershire?
It wasn't too different. I mean, it rained a lot more, actually, but it wasn't too different. Of course, having the national sport as rugby as well made a big change. On international days, it was quite an exciting place to be.
Yes, they take the rugby very seriously.
Very, very seriously. And as a football man as well, or soccer as you would call it out here, that was quite a culture shock for me.
Cardiff, as far as I remember, was the main coal port for South Wales.
It was a long time ago now. I don't think they're still mining coal there, but I was a little way away from the Cardiff base. I didn't get to see much of the industrial side of it. I was very much rooted in the university, really.
So what's special about Cardiff as a town these days?
Well, for me, the best thing bit about it was the fact that it's a capital city, but it's still very small. It's probably not really any bigger than Adelaide itself. And so there was a huge amount packed in there, two symphony orchestras, and where, of course, Adelaide's only got the one. And so there was a huge amount packed in, but I didn't have to go very far to get it all. And at most, the Cardiff Bay was a short bus ride away to go down to the Millennium Centre down there, which is where both orchestras are based.
So a rich cultural life.
Oh, very much so.
Yes. Oh, that's a good place to be sort of a student.
Oh, it's an excellent place to be a student. There's a music college there as well, so in addition to the university, so I got all of the benefits of that as well.
And I gather from the introduction that you also got a chance to play in a major orchestra there.
Oh, that was quite an experience, that was. My teacher was the second horn player in the Welsh National Opera, and through him I got the opportunity to audition with the orchestra, just on a special one-off. They called it the Children's Proms. They called it the Welsh Children's Proms. And it was quite an experience. I mean, on the basis of that, rehearsing with the orchestra and seeing how they work was very much a turning point and made me want to pursue this career a little bit further.
Yeah, you can learn a tremendous amount by working with sort of a real group like that. I know my own field is geophysics, and we always got people out working with the mining companies. And you learn so much that the university is not trying to teach you that kind of thing. It's how you organise all the activities. Anyway, horn playing. What attracted you to playing the horn?
Well, it's my mum's fault, really. I grew up with classical music all around the house. I mean, I'm from quite a musical family anyway. And every time the horn came on the radio or on a CD that she was playing, it was always pointed out to me because it was her favourite instrument. Now, the reason why it was her favourite instrument was because when she was at school, she was very good friends with a horn player there, and he sort of passed his love of it on to her. And now I recently met said horn player, who's now the principal horn player in the London Symphony Orchestra, which is one of the top orchestras in the world. He was very good. I went to see a few concerts that he was playing in. He got me a few complimentary tickets as well, which is always good fun.
Of course, the other thing that the brass instruments you associate with are the brass bands. Are they still active?
Oh, very much so, yeah. I actually started playing in a brass band before I played the French horn. I played the euphonium, which is sort of like a smaller version of the tuba. And I played one of those from about the age of 8 till I think must have been about 13 before I switched to the French horn. And that was in a brass band.
Presumably playing the French horn's fairly heavy. You've got to be mature before you can tackle it up.
Well, we do have smaller horns, baby ones, that we give to the younger kids these days. But it is actually, all instruments really, sat quite still in what is quite an unusual position for a long periods of time. So you've got to develop the right muscles.